Okay. So here's a nice big raven. A lot of times when you go into the field, you're not going to have room to store a round skin of a bird like this before you take it back to your institution. So a really good strategy is to salt in the field. It's pretty shocking how well it preserves the birds. I mean, you know, those of us in our generation that, you know, that we refrigerate everything, we sort of get surprised by that sort of thing. Our ancestors probably knew a lot better about that than we do. What you're going to do is you're going to have the salted bird in a bag in the end. So what I usually do is I salt the bird in the bag. So you can take the bag here and just roll down the edges like this. Place the bird inside. This way, you know, when you're out in the middle of nowhere too, you're not wasting salt by getting it all over the floor of the skinning tent. And so, that, you know, I put the bird on its back and just start pouring salt on. And I tend to err on the side of being generous with the salt. It seems to work all right.
How moist is your skin?
This one?
Yeah.
It's fairly moist. It's like you're doing a fresh bird. Mm-hmm. I have actually also heard, I've never tried this, but I've been told that some people actually put a lot of water in the bird and in the bag and, you know, preserve it sort of in a slurry. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, because of course you're going to have to wash the bird anyway, you know, when you get back. And I've heard that works well. I've never had a problem with birds decomposing at all. Salted birds, I kept a cracks one time in like, you know, 95 degree heat for a couple of weeks in the skinning tent. Got it back to the museum and had really no sign of rotting or anything like that. What's that?
No slippage?
Nothing. And as a matter of fact, I actually, while I was working on the bird, I cut my thumb really, really deeply. So I got all of that, you know, 2 weeks in, you know, South America in the skinning tent into my thumb. And I got stitches and they gave me antibiotics to, you know, to take. And I never took the antibiotics and never had a problem. Amazing.
So salt your
thumbs. Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, the bird was already actually even washed when I did it. And so that grease that got in that wound was, you know, old grease that had just not rotted at all. So I just take and I pour a little bit into there. And the most important thing that you have to remember is, and I think this is a mistake that some people make, you have to evert any pocket of skin. Anywhere the inside of the skin is touching a bone, you know, pull that tibia tarsus all the way out and rub the salt in it real good. This is a coarse salt. I just usually use whatever I can get in the country that I'm working in. And it's usually just regular old table salt.
Doesn't need to be iodized.
Yeah, that's for you.
Yeah.
What about borax? Can you use that or is it not
Well, I don't think borax would keep a skin like that, you know, in those conditions.
We've got some specimens that where someone got
And borax is really just a desiccant.
I also tax service can use it for storage.
Yeah, and remember, the things that taxidermists can get away with, we really can't, because taxidermists are creating sort of artwork that only needs to last for the lifetime of the person that's paying them.
This is true. It's true.
Okay, so I've salted that tibia tarsus really good and the skin that went around it. So then I can pull it back, and you'll have salt in that pocket where you know, after you revert it. So I'm just going to do that on the other side.
Solid salt as well, like in the,
would you say?
Do you fill that socket then as well?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, well, it is just the act of, you know, having salted it so well, you see that there's all salt on there. You pull it back and it's still there. Yeah, that's plenty.
I think sometimes people think you need to, like, pack it, but really that's way overkill. You mostly just need to expose the whole surface to create this basically hyper-saline environment. Mm-hmm. It doesn't need to be a pound of salt. It just needs to be a full coating.
So I've already done the other side. I'm going to pull that out. And of course, then you have to do where the tail is and make sure you get a nice amount of salt in this pocket down in here.
I think on a big-legged bird, you would have to, like, open up the feet before.
Yeah, I would have already done that, actually. There's a couple of things on this bird. I cut the tibia tarsus, like, right here. The joint is still here. It looks really nice, and it was really nicely done.
You can always cut it off, but yes. It's really hard to glue it on. So I didn't know what you wanted, so go for it.
This is nice. Yeah, I guess so. Poultry.
They're from a veterinary school.
Well, I guess I need, like, a toothpick now to get the marrow out.
Yeah, we've got a few.
Yeah.
Well, I'm trying to remember. It was like a Paraguay 1999 expedition, and it's Christoph and Terry, and we got a marabou stork kind of accidentally in camp. One of our camp cooks took it upon himself.
Jabbers.
Or a jabber. Took it upon himself to collect a stork for us, and we did not know what to do with the thing. And we tried to salt it, and we did have a problem with slippage because you had to open up the hand.
Right, the manus. You've got to get that manus open because there's a little bit of meat in there, and if it, especially if any moisture gets in there, it will rot and you'll lose several of your primaries. Yeah. So it's absolutely critical that you make a slit in there, and I actually chop out quite a bit of that meat, and then work salt into that. And then you're good.
But that's a pretty big bird.
Yeah. I mean, but even something like a turkey vulture, you've mm-hmm. got to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do it with. I mean, anything that's big enough that needs to be salted, I do that.
Yeah.
You open up the manus.
Yeah.
And
Well, if it's smaller bird, we're like, not going to salt.
You're making a round skin.
You're making a skin.
Oh,
field.
Yeah. Right.
So the salting is typically for large birds.
Yep.
Then do you have that drying rack or drying setup in the junior field camp?
Yeah, we got a sweet one.
Yeah, it's great.
You copied ours.
Yeah, we did. Go ahead. It's wonderful.
We have a black box, we call it. And it's just it's just a hard plastic, basically.
Okay.
And inside of it, we have a half-inch foam core board. And then on top of the foam core board, we put little polymerizers, just pieces like one by whatever pieces of wood, and they act as a way of stacking those inside the box.
So you have these trays.
Trays. So you have stacked trays inside of a box, and it fits. Our box fits about seven trays.
And you put that out in the sun, and you wouldn't believe how high it gets warm in there.
It acts as a treatment method for your aphids.
How hot does it get?
I haven't.
We've melted a thermometer inside of it.
Yeah.
That was in Guyana where it was. Yeah. We were out in the Rupanui and out in Savannah where it was like African conditions. Put a thermometer in there and we went to check it and it had melted. Us dinosaurs have been doing this for a lot of years. The old LSU method was we built little racks inside the tin, have a lantern that was, you know, as heat would rise from it, and we had this rig of trays in there. But this black box is more preferable. But there are situations where you don't have the sun and you have to use an alternate source of drying, and a lantern is a good way to do that.
Okay.
Gary, do you have any other?
Use fire. A zinc roof is a very good placed wood bird, but have a little prepared screening around that you can enclose everything.
Right.
All sorts of flies and maggots and everything else.
That's a real good point about flies blowing eggs on your specimens, and oftentimes if we do have them out in the sun, say we don't have our drying rack or whatever, we'll put cheesecloth over the top of the specimens if they're sitting out in the sun, so the flies will go in and blow eggs on your specimens. They go right into the nares, that's where they look, because they know there's meat in there. So
I'm working on the wings now. I just did one wing. I evert them exactly the way that I did the leg. Another real big pocket in the bird that you gotta make sure you gotta get salt in there.
Can you use a scalpel or something like that?
I don't know. The other one came out real easy.
Has there been any trends in terms of tumors the last few years in terms of environmental toxins and stuff that they go through for persons?
Often we come across, you know, cancerous growths inside birds, like, you know, like the ovary will have this huge growth on it. I mean, it's not common by any means. But I can't tell you if I've seen more in the last 10 years than
I have noticed.
I think maybe you guys have an opinion on this too. I think if a bird was to die from a cannon, I mean, we probably miss most of those birds. Like the things that are salvaged, things that hit windows or cars, and maybe if these other things are just dying from abnormality, we're less likely to get them.
That's right.
I don't know. But,
no, I think that's exactly right.
They could be part of it as well.
Yeah. But there's definitely a bias.
Because there's a bias in how we get them, right there.
Yeah.
That picture I showed that had something interesting off the intestine. That was a nestling barn owl that was actually brought in by the person who's doing the film in the back, Roy Teo. And I don't know enough to know whether it was cancer or not, but that nestling was not in the nest. Whether it was the cause of death, you really don't know.
So I'm cutting the radius off now. And cutting the joint off the ulna.
Do you need wood dowels to push that bone marrow out? You got some?
Yeah, I'm all right. Okay. Yeah, thank you. This marrow is actually pretty dry. Sometimes you open it up and it's, you know, like white and really fatty.
And that's when you're sucking on it, right?
Yeah. One of those times.
That raven is 2006.
Oh, okay.
And that one was one of those unpleasant surprises. That was a rodenticide.
Uh huh.
It was a bloody mess.
Yeah, so that's one, if you're at the end of a trip and you're out in the middle of nowhere and the food's running out, you don't eat that one. I got food coma one time from eating one sardine. At the end of a trip when you're really running out of food. Okay, and then I just pull it back out and all the salt goes in there with it. And then ready to work on the head. So of course, obviously you're gonna have to get a lot of salt into that.
No, I didn't know how much of the skull you wanted off, so I left most.
That's perfect. That's great.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no. Sorry, I got that mixed up with another bird.
Yeah, this one looks good.
You made me want to skin it.
Yeah, thank you for getting all these things ready for us. It makes it easy.
So I'm just gonna...
Do we get to take these home?
You got the burner?
Remember slide one.
Actually, I was supposed to show that for the... before the start of the second part. For anyone who is, it wasn't at part one, you need a permit. I think everyone in this audience knows all about applying for permits.
So then once I'm satisfied with, you know, the coverage of salt in there, and you want to do this quickly because the feathers start to get mangled a little bit, go ahead and revert it. And I like to see if some salt comes out the beak and out the eyes as well.
you need a permit to prepare a specimen of a legally applicable permit?
No, not to prep, but...
If someone wants to try it, amateur, and come out and do a rough grouse?
But if you pick up a passing migrant, then you need to have stuff.
Okay. So all of the areas with folds and whatnot seem to have plenty of salt in them. And so then I just sort of shake a little salt into the bag for sort of the outside of the bird. Really, I mean, it's sort of on its back in the bottom of the bag, and so the salt that I put in the cavity is still in there. Then I just shake it up a little bit. If you're in a remote area, this sits at in the skinning tent and will keep amazingly well, much better than you really imagine it possibly could.